So this is the first video from these notes. I didn't make a video for subsections 1.1 and 1.2 because I think you can probably read through those yourself and understand them. So I'm assuming you've read subsections 1.1 and 1.2, and so in particular you know what a stochastic process is. And the thing with stochastic processes is that they can be really complicated, right? A single random variable we're quite good at by now. If you've got two random variables that are dependent on each other, that can be a little bit awkward. But with a stochastic process, we've got a whole sequence of random variables that depend on each other. There could be infinitely many of them. There could be uncountably infinitely many of them. So that object can be super, super complicated. So what we want to do is we want to restrict ourselves to not all of the stochastic processes, just some of them. And we'd like the ones that we deal with to be a bit simpler, so they're not as complicated as the full stochastic processes. But we don't want to go so simple that we don't have any interesting examples anymore. So we want to squash down to some simpler stochastic processes, but such that there are still plenty of useful and interesting examples for us to study. And it turns out a good place to look is in what we will call the Markov processes, as in the title of this course, Introduction to Markov Processes. The Markov processes are simpler than the general stochastic processes, so we'll be able to study them and find out things and work with them. But there's still lots and lots of interesting examples of Markov processes. And so the Markov processes are the stochastic processes that have this Markov property. And what I want to do here is explain what the Markov property is. And so we're going to deal with discrete time to start with. We'll do continuous time much later in the course. And so we're going to start with an example, which is just a simple game of rolling a dice and moving a counter forward on a board. So we start on square number 0, we roll a dice, maybe it's a 4, and we move forward to square number 4. We roll a dice again, maybe it's a 2, that moves us on to 4, 5, 6. On to square 6, roll a dice, it's a 5, we move on to 11, and so on. So let's let xn be the square that we're on after n rolls. Okay, so after n rolls, we're on square xn. And so the next square after this roll is xn plus 1. And so what can we say about xn plus 1? The first thing we can say is that it's random, right? Xn plus 1 is random because it depends on the random roll of the dice. If we get a 6, we'll be moving on 6 squares. If we get a 1, we'll be moving on 1 square. So xn plus 1 is random, so we do have a stochastic process here. Second point is that xn plus 1 depends on xn, right? Xn and xn plus 1 are not independent random variables, they depend on each other, because if we're on square xn equals 20, then xn plus 1 is going to be somewhere between 21 and 26, for example. So xn plus 1 does depend on xn. However, and this third point is the crucial one, if I tell you I'm on square number 6, say, so xn equals 6, you don't care whether I got there with a 2, then a 4, or a 3, then a 3, or a 5, then a 1. Right? You only care on where I am now, but you don't care how I got there. So the way we say this is, given xn, xn plus 1 doesn't depend any further on the history of the process up until then. So that would be x0, x1, up to xn minus 1, the previous go. So it's this third thing that is the Markov property. It matters where we are now, but it doesn't matter how we got here. The future depends on the present, but given the present, it doesn't depend any further on the past. So that's what the Markov property is, and we're going to just want to write that down in maths. But you'll notice here we have this word given. And so in probability, when we say given such and such, that's conditional probability, right? You might remember that the conditional probability of an event A given B, you might remember that we write that like this, PA given B. And so that's the probability that A happens, given that we know that B has definitely happened. You might remember from previous courses that this has a definition, which is that it's the probability of A and B, divided by the probability of B. But actually, we don't really use that formula in this course very much. We normally reason directly about the conditional probability of A given B. Okay, so now that we have the notation for the probability of something given something else, we can write down the Markov property, which is this. Now, let's have a look at what we have in this equation here. First, we have this term, xn plus 1. So that's about what happens on the next step, right? That's about the future. We also have this term about xn. So xn is the square that we're on now. And then we also have these terms here from xn minus 1 down to x0. So those are all the things that happened in the past. So on the left-hand side of this equation, we've got the probability that something happens in the future, given where we are now and given the entire past. Whereas the right-hand side is what happens in the future, just given where we are now. And those two terms are equal. So if this equation holds for all times n and for all states x0 up to xn plus 1, what we're saying is that this doesn't matter. The past doesn't matter. If we want to know about the future, all we need to know about is where we are now. And that's the Markov property. So we're going to be looking in this course at stochastic processes where this does hold. And thus, if we want to know about the future, we only need to know where we are now, and we can forget all about the past. And that will make our stochastic processes much easier to deal with. So in the next section of the notes, we'll be looking at our first example of a Markov process, which will be a stochastic process that has this Markov property.